Do you want to learn how to calculate the ultimate moment resistance of a concrete section using the strain compatibility method? If the answer is yes, then this video is for you. I'm going to go through an example and show you how to calculate the moment capacity of a cross section using the strain compatibility method. I've already drawn my cross section. As you can see, the top flange width is 1200 millimeter and is 200 millimeter deep, and our web is 1 meter wide and 1050 millimeter deep, and we are using 16 number 40 mil diameter longitudinal reinforcement, and I have already calculated our effective depth, which is 1168 millimeter, and we are using rectangular stress block for this example. I've drawn that stress block and the compressive forces, also the strains diagram here. FCK is 40 megapascal, gamma C is 1.5. We will be using alpha CC as 0.85. For the reinforcement, FIK is 500 megapascal and gamma S is 1.1. First thing I'm gonna do is calculate the area of longitudinal reinforcement, which is AS. 5 times 40 over 2 squared times 16 number bars. C is equal to 3D. Design value of our concrete strength is going to be alpha CC times CK over gamma C, which is 0.85 times 40 over 1.5. This comes to 22.67 megapascal. So we're going to calculate FYD for our reinforcement, which is FYK over gamma S is equal to 500 for 1.15. It's going to be 434.78 megapascal. One thing I forgot to mention is reinforcing steel modulus of elasticity is going to be ES is 200 gigapascal. Then we can calculate the yield strain of reinforcement, which is epsilon is yield is equal to FYD over ES, which is 434.78 over, this is in megapascal and 200 gigapascal. This is going to be 0.002. Effective height of compression zone factor, which is lambda. If our FCK is below 50 megapascal, then our lambda is going to be 0.8. And the effective strength factor, neta, for FCK below 50 megapascal is going to be 1. And I've already mentioned epsilon CU3 is 0.0035. What I've done here in this example, I've already calculated what the correct neutral axis depth is, which is X value here, and I'm going to use that for this example, otherwise this is going to be a lengthy repetitive process. If you would like me to explain this process, iterative process, in detail, please let me know. I will do another video on that topic. Assume effective depth X is 432 millimeter. Hence, we can calculate effective height of compression zone. In here, we've already mentioned it is lambda x, lambda x is equal to 0.8 times 432, which is 345.6 millimeter. Then what we need to do is calculate the centroid of compression zone within the flange, which is in this area. I've noted that as L1. As you can see, our neutral axis is lying below the flange, so we can easily calculate this L1. L1 is half of the depth of the flange, which is 200 over 2, is going to be 100 millimeter. Then we need to calculate the centroid of compression zone in the web, which is this section below this dashed line. We need to calculate the centroid and the distance from the top of the section to the centroid, which is L2. We can calculate L2. We can write L2 as lambda x minus the depth of the flange over 2 plus the depth of the flange, which is 345.6 minus 200 over 2 plus 200. L2 is equal to 272.8 millimeter. Then what we need to do is calculate FC1 and FC2. These are the compressive forces in the compression zone within the flange and the compression zone within the web. We can write FC1 is equal eta times FCD times width of the flange times the depth of the flange. If you convert the units, then this value is going to be 5440 kilonewton. Then we are going to calculate FC2, which is this compressive force. FC2 is equal to eta times FCD times width of the web times this distance, which we can write as lambda x minus height of flange. This is equal to 3,300.27 kilonewton. Then we can calculate the total compressive force, which is FC is equal to FC1 plus FC2, which is equal to 5,440 plus 3,300. This is equal to 8,740 kilonewton. Then we can calculate the reinforcement strain. Epsilon S is effective depth minus the depth to the neutral axis over depth to the neutral axis times epsilon Cu3. That was derived from these diagrams. C is equal to and the reinforcement strain 0.006 proves that this reinforcement steel is yielding because it's bigger than the yield strain of reinforcement. Hence, we can calculate our tension force in steel. Fs is equal to Fyd times the area of steel, which is 434.78 times the area. And if you convert the units correctly, this value is going to be 8,741.8 kilonewton. You can see that this Fs value, which is 8,742 kilonewton, is almost equal to total Fc value, which is 8,740 kilonewton. So our compressive and tensile forces are in balance. Hence, what we can do is we can take moments about any point using these forces and calculate bending moment capacity, which is M is equal to, in this example, I'm going to take bending moments about this point here. So we can write our bending capacity is equal to Fs times D, which is the effective depth, and Fc1 times L1, which is this force Fc1 and lever arm is L1. Same goes for Fc2, and lever arm for Fc2 is L2. And if you calculate the value, then you would get 8,766 kilonewton meter. If you have any questions, please post your questions in the comment section. If you like the video, please like the video. And if you would like to see more videos like this one, please subscribe to our channel. And if you have any suggestions for future videos, if you have any questions that you would like us to cover in a video, please let us know. Thank you for watching.